We have come together to welcome and ask God's blessing upon Amy G. Oden, who's been chosen to serve as the Academic Dean of the Seminary and as Professor of History Christianity. We believe she is well qualified and that she has been prayerfully selected and duly called to this ministry. Amy, do you in the presence of this congregation commit yourself to this new trust and responsibility?
In faith, trusting in the grace of God, I do.
Upon consultation with the faculty and the consent of the governors, you have been appointed by me to serve as Dean of Wesley Theological Seminary. Therefore, I ask you to declare publicly the commitment you have already made, that we may all witness and respond to your declaration, and that we may pray for your ministry of administration and instruction in our midst. Do you trust that you have been guided by God to assume the office of Dean, and do you seek gifts and grace necessary for this work?
I do.
It is your task as Dean to preside over the faculty here assembled for the sake of guidance, support, and counsel. Do you resolve so to work with this faculty in matters of curriculum and academic administration, that the church may serve the world through those we train as pastors, teachers, and leaders?
I am resolved. So to work with the members of this faculty who are my colleagues to these tasks, and to oversee the guidance of students in theological education and personal development ministry. I also commit to work with the staff and administration of the seminary to foster faith and living.
It is my great privilege to offer this charge to our Dean here in Saul today, Dean Amy Oden. As you take up the special role and office of Dean at Wesley Theological Seminary, I charge you to remember that to be a dean is also a calling and a ministry. God calls you to the vocation of standing in the midst of this community and its needs and its challenges, and every part of this community depends on the faithful ministry that you undertake to serve and further the mission of this school. I charge you to continue your work of scholarship and teaching, even as you take on new duties and responsibilities. You come to this role from the faculty and must remain in touch with the realities of the teaching and learning experience at the heart of theological education. I charge you to find the grace needed at the heart of administrative tasks, of difficult decisions, of necessary paperwork, of constant communication, and of human interactions. Know that the grace seen in such day-to-day work mediates the grace of God, even in institutional processes. I charge you to stand between administration, faculty, students, and staff, to listen to and speak in behalf of all as needed. You are the dean of the seminary, not of any one group, and we count on your wisdom to give perspective and guidance in the issues, challenges that affect all. And I charge you to care for your own person as the steward of the personal gifts you bring to your deanly work. Take the time to care for your health, to nourish your spirit, to deepen your own wisdom, and to give time to relationships. We need you whole in body, mind, and spirit for the vocational journey of your leadership at Wesley. As the sixth full-time dean in the history of Wesley Theological Seminary, you are trusted in this moment and in the days ahead to lead us in the confidence that God will give you the wisdom and grace needed for the journey. Blessings to you on this special day.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who has granted each of us a place and part of Wesley Theological Seminary, make hallowed to us now this special occasion. As we bless Amy G. Oden in her new ministry, let us also dedicate ourselves to the life and work to which you have called us all. Help us to remember on this special and holy day. Remember our gratitude for the homes, schools, and churches from which we all have come. That in this new opportunity of servant leadership for Amy Oden, that we keep faith with those who have gone before her and those whose hopes will follow all of us here. That she may enter with good courage, good humor, and constant purpose upon the tasks that await her. Deliver her, O God, from all sense of strangeness and loneliness in this new ministry. Protect her from any temptation that might come upon her to go it alone in her new responsibilities. Help her eyes to remain wide open to new opportunities for teaching and learning for the good of the whole seminary community. Most especially, we would ask your grace, wisdom, and courage to be upon Amy Oden as she takes up the mantle of leadership as dean. Fill her with every grace she will need to do this important work. Surround her with supportive community and genuine colleagues who want to guarantee her success and service. Lend now your blessings to Amy and to us all as we recommit ourselves to your dreams and your hopes for the strength of this wonderful and special place called Wesley Theological Seminary. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray your blessing, abundant power, and peace to be upon your servant and our sister and friend, Amy G. Oden. Amen.
Join me in prayer. Eternal God, we, your gathered people, come to us with hearts of faith and hearts rejoicing. Now, O God, we come in this moment seeking to hear from you through your holy and inspired word. Open our eyes, open our hearts, open our minds that we may hear what you are saying, that this divine instruction may come to us and through us. In the name of the Christ we pray. Amen. Hear a reading from the second letter to the church at Corinth, chapter 6, verses 11 through 13. Dear Corinthians, I can't tell you how much I long for you to enter this wide open, spacious life. We didn't fence you in. The smallness you feel comes from within you. Your lives aren't small, but you're living them in a small way. I'm speaking as plainly as I can and with great affection. Open up your lives. Live openly and expansively.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 20, verses 1 through 16. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You also, go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And then about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." And he said to them, "You also go into my vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call all the laborers, give them their pay, beginning with the last, and then go into the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now, when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only an hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them and said, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I'm so blessed that each of you are here, and I'm so grateful for the Wesley community that surrounds me and gives me life. So thanks to the faculty, the staff and administration, the students, the alums, governors, friends, the seminary, my family who's here, all of you that come to celebrate this day with us, to mark this moment. I'm deeply moved. So we have a gospel text this week from Matthew. You probably know the story. All the workers lined up for payment in order of how many hours they've worked. A very clear sense in that line of who worked how much. If you've ever had to punch a time clock, you know the feeling. The boss keeps track of exactly how many hours, when you clock in, when you clock out. You get paid for the hours you work. And in this story, those who work the fewest hours get paid first. Surely they were surprised when, wow, they got a full day's pay. And if you're one of those who've been working all day, you're thinking, cool, if they get a day's wage, just think what we're going to get. I've been in the scorching heat all day. It's coming soon. And to be honest, most of the time we identify with the all-day workers. We like to think of ourselves as decent, hard-working folks. We're committed to our jobs. We do the work. So, just when things should start feeling good in the story, they don't. Just when we should be getting our due recognition, the tables are turned, and we get very hard news. The boss gives us the same payment as the others. Are you kidding me? This is not turning out the way it should. On the big scoreboard in the sky, we should be way ahead. For these workers, keeping score leaves them resentful and dissatisfied, even when they get exactly what they were promised. Even when, at the most basic level of justice, the boss pays what he said he would. But now, it feels like not enough, because they are keeping score. The psychology of scarcity kicks in. Why don't we have more? Our pay is not enough. Their full day's work feels diminished, dishonored by the payment that sounded pretty good at the beginning of the day. Their lives become small, fenced in, pressed. For us, scorekeeping in our personal lives, in our church families, in our seminary community, is a temptation that creeps into all corners. It's in the cultural air we breathe. It's the way of the world. In our national political life, scorekeeping rules the day, especially when budgets are slashed and public leaders make tough decisions about who will go without education, without health care, without a living wage. In hard economic times, we keep score at home, and Congress, at work, in foreign aid. The politics of scarcity seem like plain common sense. So we point fingers, blame others, feel diminished. And as Paul says to the Corinthians, we lead small lives. And the churches in Corinth had been doing plenty of scorekeeping. Paul himself had been doing plenty of scorekeeping. And the second letter to the Corinthians is full of many of those scores, hashed and rehashed. The big scoreboard in the sky, or however each of us keeps score in our lives, mostly diminishes us and makes us believe that we don't have enough of whatever it is, power, recognition, reward. Scorekeeping makes our lives puny, tight, compressed. And when we find ourselves fenced in, resentful, diminished, if we follow that trail back to its origin, it's likely we are keeping score. Yet scorekeeping rarely leads to justice because it causes our vision to retract, to look to getting mine, to become fenced in. On the other hand, the voice of justice that speaks on behalf of the most who have the least speaks truth to power and offers a new vision of God's desire. The voice of justice opens up possibilities and creates room for God to do a new thing. Into this temptation to keep score, Paul speaks a word of life. Dear, dear Corinthians, how I long for you to enter this wide, open, spacious life. Your lives aren't small, but you're living them in a small way. Open up your lives, live openly and expansively. You probably recognize this as Eugene Peterson's poetic translation of these verses. And Paul, of course, gets the basic message from Jesus, who proclaimed, "The reign of God is at hand. Scorekeeping is over." In fact, this God of Jesus doesn't seem very interested in keeping score at all. The landowner chooses to be generous. Jesus tells us about the father who welcomes home a prodigal son with open arms and welcomes the elder, stiff-necked brother with everything he has. Jesus tells us about a Samaritan who rescues an enemy rather than keep score, about outcasts who are invited to the banquet, about an unlikely woman at a well who was one of the first to recognize the Messiah in this God's life. Jesus says, the blind see, the lame walk, rather than deserving the illness they have on the big scoreboard in the sky. Even Zacchaeus the tax collector receives salvation this day. No more scorekeeping. The wide open, spacious life of God, a radical refutation of that big scoreboard in the sky. I I struggle in my own life with this. Am I doing enough? Does my work contribute to God's mission in the world? Am I getting on the scoreboard? On my last sabbatical, I struggled with God and with myself. What does the world need that I can offer? How can I love the world the way God does? Does the world really need another book? Another lecture? This line of reflection leads me to some other uncomfortable question. Does the world need another MDiv degree? Or Wesley? Or theological education altogether? Does what we do really matter in God's life? I did end up writing the book, but frankly, at the time, I wasn't sure it was the most faithful thing to do. I feel differently now, several years later, and this is why. Whether I'm doing enough isn't the question, because that question is the scorekeeping question. If I listen to Jesus and to Paul, then my gaze turns from the scoreboard to the expansive life of God. So even in writing my book, even here in a mainline seminary, some would say the most unlikeliest of places, that expansive life of God is at work, and we participate in God's movement in the world in unique ways at Wesley to bless God and to bless the world. And I want to say a word or two about how we do that. First, in theological education, we have a unique blessing in that among the many, many tasks we are given, one central task is to live deeply, explore this expansive life of God. In all of our scholarship and study, in every course and conversation, we are canvassing the revelation of God, of the Holy One, in all its variety and embodiment, in scripture, tradition, in all of creation and human life. We are tasked in the arts with creating new vocabularies to describe the expanse of the divine. In biblical study with deep breathing the scriptures. In history, we take long walks with Perpetua and Abelard. In education and pastoral care, we grasp the rhythms of healing and growth in human life. In preaching and worship, with cultivating congregational practices that produce the fruit in our communities. In theology and ethics, with going to the mat to wrestle with how God allows suffering in the world. This work, this teaching and learning is itself a means of grace, God's own life revealed in our work. And we come face to face with the mystery and the grace of God over and over again. This faculty, my colleagues, embody the great grace of this task. There is never a question that this is who we are and this is what we do. And I continue to be in awe of the passion, the joy, the challenge with which this faculty undertakes the task. We proclaim God's wide, open, spacious life, and we cultivate leaders who will proclaim it too. In this time and in this place, theological education has a historic opportunity, I believe, to play a new role in the life of the church. At a time when in some parts of the church, laity, pastors, denominational leaders are unsure about whether they matter. They may be demoralized or weary, tempted to keep score, or to feel small and fenced in. We can be, for the church, a source of energy, of life, a voice of confidence in the spirits moving in the world, because we have the luxury of being daily steeped in the wide, open, spacious life of God. We can say, look, see, the kingdom of God is at hand. We point to the living God whose insistent mission is alive and well in the church and outside the church. Just come hang out with our students for a day. I'm grateful that at Wesley we have embraced the role of confidence and encouragement for the present and future body of Christ in the world. And we can perhaps say more confidently than theological education has said for the last 100 years, we can confidently say that we have good news for the church and the world, both of whom are desperate to hear it. The workers who began late in the day didn't know they would receive a full day's wage, surely didn't expect it. Can you imagine the good news when they received their pay? Like the workers who came at the end of the day, or those who weren't hired at all that day, there are many in our own world today who stand outside God's life, outside beloved community, with their nose pressed against the glass, looking in, believing they don't belong, or haven't done enough to deserve being let in on the big scoreboard that surely God keeps. So many think that because they didn't come to work in the first hour of the day, the good news isn't for them, because they don't go to church, or can't quite seem to get their act together, or aren't sure they believe in God, or have doubts about the Bible. The good news isn't for them. And you know them. They're at your place of work, maybe in your family, in our churches, and even our seminary classrooms. Many hungry for the good news of God's generosity, mercy, and grace. The good news that scorekeeping is over. Our confidence in the good news means we proclaim the freedom to the captive, justice for all God's children, the flourishing of human life and all creation, the bondage of human sin that leads to injustice, our pride, our sense of entitlement, our greed. This bondage makes us believe in the grand lie that we must keep score, that we must be small, or that bondage can only be broken through violence. Instead, the gospel offers the freedom and the room to imagine new relationships among peoples and nations, among economies and families. And it may surprise some of us in theological education to find that our role, more than ever before, is to be good newsers, proclaimers of this wide open, spacious life. Let me be clear, it's not warm and fuzzy. This work of theological education, of being a voice of confidence and encouragement about God's mission in the world, it can be frustratingly painful, disappointingly difficult, work that too often seems like not enough. But I like the idea of prevenient courage. I get this from John Ames, the central character in the moving novel Gilead by Marilynne Robinson. He's a pastor in the last days of his life. Reflecting on his own life, he says, theologians talk about prevenient grace that precedes grace itself and allows us to accept it. I think there must also be a prevenient courage that allows us to be brave. A prevenient courage that allows us to be brave. And so Jesus says to the workers in the vineyard, how I long for you to enter this wide open, spacious life. by telling this story of no longer keeping score. And Paul says to us, dear, dear Wesley Seminary community, how I long for you to enter this wide open spacious life. And to our congregations and to the world, to all of us, dear, dear brothers and sisters, how I long for you to enter this wide open spacious life. Your lives aren't small, but you're living them in a small way. Open up your lives. Through prevenient courage and prevenient grace, we enter God's life, living in it every day here at Wesley, and in turn, welcoming the world into this expanse. When we ride the bus or write a paper, we step into the wide open spacious life. When we study scripture or figure out a problem in data tell, we enter the wide open spacious life, sharing a meal in the refectory, in meetings, at your internship sites, teaching a class. We enter the wide open spacious life. In those late night conversations with classmates that you disagree with, in creating a web video series on the seminary, we step into God's own life. In boring and unremarkable, in wondrous and revelatory moments. And let me assure you, students, we do not function as a waiting room for real ministry. Seminary is not a holding tank for when your real call will begin once you've graduated. We are the church, here, now. We are the people of God, day in and day out, struggling to love each other and the world that God loves, and imagining what God longs for. Each day, students, you enter God's wide open, spacious life. So to all of us, we proclaim here now the good news of Jesus Christ. Scorekeeping is over. The reign of God is at hand. With God's help, live openly and expansively. Enter God's wide open, spacious life. It is for you. It is for the world. Amen.
Draw the circle. Draw the circle wide. Draw the circle. Draw the circle wide. No one stands alone. We'll stand side. Draw the circle, draw the circle wide.
No one stands alone, we'll stand side by side.
Draw the circle. Draw the circle.
And the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.
Amen.